Welcome to everyone this morning on this bright sunshiny day, Shabbat. It is February 5th, 2022, and also the 11th month, the 16th day on our Enochian calendar. It's so good to see you all. I feel like I do this every morning now that I'm teaching fifth graders online. I hit the admit all button right on the dot, and all of these beautiful, sunshiny 10 and 11-year-old faces pop up. I see a lot of names here in our Shabbat service. I don't know. Sometimes it's just nice to stay in your jammies and not totally get together, but sometimes I find that if I'm prepared physically, then my mind is more sharp and alert and open to what the Spirit might be saying for us today.
You're so like to go through ritual ablutions in the morning, don't you? Yeah.
Well, I take communion and pray and yeah. I mean, it just sets me up for being more in tune with the Ruach. I just find that just sets me up for the day to be a more meaningful, productive, more in tune to the Spirit kind of day. And this morning I was just prompted by something I read somewhere, reminded me of the shalom. We always wish each other Sabbath peace. And I thought of the Master in John chapter 14, when he said to his disciples, he said, "Shalom, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled. Do not let them be afraid." So that's a good word for us today, that our peace, the Sabbath peace that we wish one another, is peace from the Master, not from the world. So, Father, we are here today to wish each other peace, but mostly to honor and to bless you and to thank you for this set apart day that you give us. 6 days, we do all of our work, we labor, get all of our duties done. And this day, our hearts are open to you. You know our hearts already. No secrets for you. And I pray that you would give that special shalom to each person here today and those who will listen later. Remembering, as our Master said, that this peace is not from the world. It's so much deeper, so much greater. Even in the midst of chaos and heartache and difficulties, we can know your shalom. Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen. Heisen. This is the Liturgy of Searing Questions, number 9 from the Dead Sea Scrolls, right here at New Earth Restoration. A division of the Vero Essene Yahad, and I too welcome you all here. It's a great thing to be able to get together. It's like Zoom is a miracle for we who will take advantage of it. It's very many benefits. And we thank you, Father, for Zoom, else we wouldn't be able to come together. So we say to those gates, lift up your heads, so ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors, so the Malach Kavod may come in. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors. Arise, arise, lift up your heads, O ye gates, lift up your heads, O ye gates, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors, So the Malach Kavod may come in, may come in. So the Malach Kavod may come in. So the Malach Kavod may come in, may come in. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. Oh, lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors.
The meditation, Psalm 61. Hear my cry, O Yahweh. Listen to my prayer. From the end of the earth I call to you when my heart is faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I, for you are my refuge, a strong tower against the enemy. Let me abide in your tent forever. Find refuge under the shelter of your wings, for you, O Yah, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name. Prolong the life of the king. May his years endure to all generations. May he be enthroned forever before Elohim. Appoint steadfast love and faithfulness to watch over him. So I will always sing praises to your name as I pay my vows day after day. The gateposts. So what did you see within the gates?
We saw Yahweh sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him.
Kadosh.
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 Kadosh. Such is Yahweh of armed forces. The whole world is full of his radiance.
Let those portals shake and the house be filled with smoke.
Whoa! But are we not lost? Or are we not the people of unclean lips? And do we not live among people of unclean lips? Yet our eyes have seen the King, Yahweh of armed forces.
Did not a seraph fly to you holding a live coal from the altar? And did they not touch your mouths and say, you are not lost?
The coal touched our lips.
And your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out. Now the voice of Yahweh says to us all, who will I send? Who will go for us?
Here I am. Send us. Send me. Send me.
So enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name.
For Yahweh is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
Yet have not our hands failed us? Have we not become dry and weary? Yea, our lives have become desolate and ebb away. Desolation is poured out day after day.
Have you not stolen our joy and kept us from prophesying of your wonders and miracles, of the splendor of your name, set us to wandering, so we refuse to eat?
Will you wander forever?
We are parched in this desert, in this dry and weary land. We are brought to nothing. But your word has become our refuge, the water stream in the wasteland. Who can depart from your presence? Who can escape your radiance? Even in the walled and guarded cities, you search for us. Even in the pit, you find us.
Oh, Yahweh, what are people that you think of them? What are lives worth since they fade away so quickly?
We will all soon come to dust, but your name lives forever.
Yahweh Elohim Saviot is that memorial name.
Amen, amen, amen. Let us bless Yahweh Saviot. From 1Q34 and 1Q34 BIS, For in the time of your goodwill, you will choose for yourselves a people. You remembered your covenant and granted that they should be separated for yourself from among all the rest. You renewed for them your covenant founded on a vivid vision and the words of your spirit on the works of your hands, even the writing of your right hand, so that they might know the foundations of radiance and the steps toward eternity.
The scrolls give us a special formula, and you will there bless the Elohim of Israel. You will say, "Blessed are you, Elohim of Israel." And the priest of the congregation will stand before you at your moed for his holocaust, for Yahweh Elohim's act of purity, and he will bless the Yahad.
Answering, the people will say, "Baruch atah Yahweh Elohim, who has delivered me from all my sins and purified me from my vile indecency and atoned for me, so I might enter his gates." The sweet, savored blood offering and its purifying result by your goodwill comprises a most pleasing memorial.
Blessed be the Father who forgives all our sin, whose mercies endure forever.
Amen. Let us again consider our unloving acts and predispositions. Then confess our wrong thoughts, actions, and omissions in the presence of Elohim and one another. Reflect, examine yourself. Take a few seconds.
Elohim of justice, righteousness, love, and forgiveness.
We believe in and bless Messiah Yeshua for his atoning sacrifice. And we confess to you, Father, and to one another, that we fall far short of expectations. We have not responded well to your gracious act of self-sacrifice on a stake as the final blood atonement against such, that is, the perfected and completed oblation for our forgiveness. But do we not neglect you? And have we not loved our neighbors as ourselves? And are we not a naturally sinful people?
Yes, and a stiff-necked or a stuff-necked people. Has not the atoning sacrifice already been completed? And is not our Messiah Yeshua alive for us today? And will our Elohim not forgive and sanctify his own people for his own sake?
True. Father, forgive us. Forgive us. Free us from the power and guilt of our iniquitous soul and the unloving acts of our hands. Please help us see more clearly your love for us and forgive us.
Purely through the grace of Elohim and Yeshua's act of self-denial, all our sins are forgiven. Yes, we are forgiven. Yes, we are clean. Now may we be strengthened daily to believe in Yeshua's presence with us and live the goodness, joy, and freedom his forgiveness brings. Go and sin no more.
Amen. Amen. And we render thanks and praise for the miracle of personal forgiveness.
So now, when we stretch out a hand or foot, we praise his name. We cry for joy as we come and go and sit and rise and lay upon the bed. Yes, we cry for joy for his work in us.
In the company of others, we praise Yahweh with these offerings, the utterances of our lips. Even before we lift our hands to enjoy the delights of the world's produce, we praise him. In the commencement of terror and dread, even in the house of affliction and distress, we continue to bless him, even for his exceedingly wondrous acts. We think hard upon his might, and then all day we lean upon his mercies.
With such words, will we not come forward and unburden ourselves of the load of petitions and supplications in hope and confidence, rightly offered as an acceptable fragrance of righteousness and perfection, as a delectable free will offering?
Yes, we surrender all. I surrender all. Let me ask at this time if there are people that would like to surrender a testimony or a prayer request, that we might lift that up before the little flock and be expectant for a testimony to come back.
So Jackson, is it true that you and your company there on First Street have to leave the area?
Well, word gets around fast, and it's looking like it. In fact, it's almost a sure thing. And we're quite dejected about it. It seems that the owner or the agent for the owner of this particular house feels like they can make a lot of money by selling this house. And evidently they're not too concerned about what happens to us in the meantime. So we're praying and we're looking, and should be today or tomorrow that we hear what the final word is on this. What we know so far is this is supposed to happen pretty quick. And boy, does the word get around. Wow. Well, that's true.
Well, so, you know, this is for the benefit of prayer, certainly from our group. And so, yeah, that's our prayer, my wife and I, for you guys.
Amen.
There's three of you there.
There's three of us here. Well, one of the things is we are trying to determine whether, well, I should say last Tuesday in our session here, as we were talking, one of our members here kind of gave a prophecy about the instability of having to move on. The question is this moving on, if it's for sure, is this something that is in the plan for us? Or on the other hand, is it the plan of the enemy? And right at this time, we're ready to accept it either way. But the prospect of a bunch of old people moving to who knows where on the very spur of the moment, that is disturbing, and I'm disturbed about that today. And I was just during the confession there, I was thinking, I was asking for help. Not that Yahweh would move in one way or the other, especially, but rather that we would feel settled in our own minds and hearts about what was going to happen. However, it never seems like in a situation like this, you actually get the word until the thing is done, until you get somewhere, and then you say, oh, now I understand. Or you say, oh, I don't understand what I'm doing here. But yes, we're looking just in the very beginning of this, and we're looking at places where we need to go. Might it be here? Might it be Tennessee? Somebody yesterday said Alaska. I don't think Alaska.
No.
Steve says, come on out to Oklahoma, Apache, Oklahoma. That sounds great. Okay, we'll come out, Steve. You build us a house.
I actually have a prayer request too, brother, if I could. I would like to lift up.
Oh, we're not done yet. Oh, yeah, go ahead.
I'd like to lift up Brother Finney and the children and the maestro over there. I think we should seriously be in be prayer for them. Thanks, brother.
I've been really concerned about Finney picking up the money we send and the possibility of being knocked on the head on the way home by these gangs. What, when you think about it, what he said on Tuesday is not only was the mother of these two children that they take care of murdered, his cousin was murdered, his neighbor was just recently murdered. And I think, well, what's going on in his neighborhood? But you've got to understand Port-au-Prince, Haiti. It's completely without rule in these days. There is no certain police. The police have been defunded a long time, and many of those are parts of gangs that are extorting this money and property from other people. So yes, he needs a hedge of protection. He needs a supernatural coat of armor. And of course, I don't think he's here today, but his heart's breaking over the whole thing. On the other hand, how wonderful it is. I'm thinking, how lucky am I? How blessed am I to have you people who have been so faithful in supporting the work down there. It's outrageous to me, and it's outrageous good thing, because you know all the turns of fate that the people in our district down there have faced here lately, and to be able to finally have some pecuniary resources to send down there to help out and know they're helping out instead of just sending to an organization that you don't know what's going to happen to the money. That's a real blessing. This last 6 months or so have been a blessing, and I thank you so much, you that are giving, and I pray that you'll get a blessing, a huge blessing out of this. In fact, that you'll live to see the fruition of the purpose of that children's ministry down there, to raise up children in Torah and in the understanding that Elohim loves them, and to get them educated and put them in places in Port-au-Prince and Haiti where they'll be able to influence others. And so that maybe in the next two or three generations, things will change. Amen. Thank you very much for that.
Jackson, should I mention what I heard this week about Haiti?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, it was in my prayer time one morning, and I wasn't really praying about Haiti. I was just communing with Abba, and I heard it's time for Haiti to be redeemed. And I began to ask for hordes of angels to go through and annihilate the evil and the gangs.
That's a good thing to pray about. You know, my mother and father, my mother especially here, since my father's been gone for quite some while, their mission to Haiti was to raise children up in education, as well as Christian education, so that the next generations could feel the effects of what they were doing. And indeed, in their career as missionaries there, they brought literally tens or even hundreds of thousands of people in. And once in a while here in Florida, I run into one of those children that had been able to get up here somehow and get a job. And what I find is when they work jobs up here, they send all their money back home to help their folks. That's something we hardly know about. And not to mention the Taino Indians, somebody just put on a chat there. These people that are in Haiti now didn't have any desire to go to Haiti. Believe me, they were brought in as slaves. And the natural inhabitants of that island were primarily killed off through the slavery of the Spanish and their diseases, to the point where there's no Tainos hardly left there. So now there has just been generations of curses after curses, which I won't go into right now. But indeed, we prayed for years, my wife and I, to extinguish those curses and to bring forth a new work there that would be efficacious when others hadn't been. And maybe this is it. I'm just overwhelmed by the response. And if you want to give to that, just go out to veroyahad.org to the donation page. And there's a category there that says Haiti Missions. And when you give, 100% goes there. Nothing is taken out. Goes straight to the work. So you can be more than happy that your money is going to be used rightly where it's needed. And of course, if you need a tax receipt, I'd be glad to see somebody decide that they wanted to get a tax break and give about $50,000 for the receipt. That would be just fine. Is Finny here today?
Not at this time.
Okay, yeah. There are also problems down there with the internet. Sometimes it's good, most times it's not.
I spoke to him yesterday. I know he was having a headache too, and so definitely keep that in prayer for Brother Finny.
Yeah, he's sick. All right, let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, Yahweh, creator of the universe, recreator of our soul and spirit, you've heard these things that we petitioned. We've given you thanks and praise. We owe you so much more. And so we pray today as a body that you will fulfill your word and your mission in that country as well as ours, and that we might, even in our generations, see the change made, see the country turn, see the showers of blessings come, and bring into the midst of those folks leaders who are firm in their establishment, first in the kingdom of Elohim, and then secondly, in their natural country. I pray that for our country too, especially right now. And Father, for all those here that give us such a wonderful feeling of blessedness every Shabbat, may they also feel the great relief of being together in congregation on Shabbat, especially those that have no other place to go where they live. Help us to evolve and do better. Help us to care about what we are trying to do here with online Shabbat service. And I don't ask that you would make this grow. That's what the church pastor asks. But I ask rather that you would grow this little congregation in spirit and in power to speak the word, and the word becomes flesh. Hallelujah. Amen. In the name of Yeshua.
Amen.
And now, my children, call to me all your brothers and gather to me all your mother's children. For a voice is calling me, and a spirit is poured out upon me, so that I may show you everything that will happen to you forever.
And with this promise of anointing and preparation, let the prophets prophesy. Today again, we have Yaakov Cramer. People like him. He's really humble. He's got a message. He's lived a difficult life. And now, at something of an advanced age, he's made a decision to step back into a full-time ministry that is one of the most difficult ones. And so I give you Brother Yaakov Cramer. Bless his heart.
Bless and thank you, Brother Jackson, and everyone in the Yahad. You can hear me, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. I have had some problems with my computer here lately, so I just have to make sure. Before I start the study that I have today, I do have some prayer requests as well. I wanted to wait till everyone else had theirs out of the way. The first one I have concerns the prisoners that I am to be ministering to, and I'm not sure, but this may be happening across the board throughout the states. They're having a lot of problems with the chaplains and those who are above the chaplains. In particular, anyone who uses the set apart names, they're giving them a lot of trouble. They've not been allowed to have access to their chapel on Shabbat. Some of them have not been able to get access to messianic videos that have been sent to them. So we need prayers for them. And two in particular, I want prayers lifted up for Brother Grady, who is in the Grafton, Ohio Correction Institute, has a trial coming up on the 9th of this month. Now, this trial concerns a petition and recompense, not just for himself, but for all of the brothers there who have been denied their rights, their religious freedoms. And they have already taken this to a judge one time. The judge reprimanded those chaplains who have been withholding their meetings and such. Right now, they're very concerned about getting the elements that are needed for Passover. And so just pray that there'll be a good judgment given to Brother Grady for the sake of all the imprisoned brothers. Another brother there is Joe Devers. He goes before the parole board on the 17th. I ask for prayers for him so that he might be released, and hopefully he can rejoin the community through ministry as well. Being that he has an inside connection, this might be a way for him to minister in a place where I cannot at this time.
You're making inroads, because one contacted me yesterday, the day before.
Wonderful.
Kronowski.
Yes, that's Grady, Brother Grady.
Okay, great.
And I'm hoping that they've been allowed to have their computer access. I think he was wanting to get onto Yahad today as well. I don't see his name up anywhere, so I'm believing they've probably denied him that request. That's, like I say, anybody who uses the set apart names, they are discriminating against very heavily. There's also another thing I would like to bring up. I think it's very important, and everyone should know about this. If you're not familiar with it, it's called the Equality Act. It's HR number 5. I recommend that you look it up and read the entirety of it. But basically, this bill aims to limit and destroy the constitutional rights that we have to not only observe, but to teach moral standards as outlined in the scriptures. If this bill passes the Senate, we will not have the ability to turn down any kind of sexual perversion that would enter into our community. We are not allowed to speak against it. We are not allowed to teach against it. And all of these things are just more of our countries, especially the, I always call them the dark side of our country, who are trying to take away all, anything that has to do with worship the true Father. And there's a place that you can go to sign a petition on this. It's called the Family Research Council, FRC. If you can bring that up on your computer, you will find a place where you can sign a petition to our senators for this. But not only signing that, but if you have the ability, call them, write to them, or email them, each one of your senators, and try to get them to understand the importance of keeping these civil rights that are guaranteed to us through our Constitution, but given to us by our Almighty One. So again, I just pray that everyone will be concerned over this. One other thing I want to bring up is we're seeing a lot of action over in the Middle East right now that our news media are not doing a lot of reporting on. The Iranians are using the Houthi to attack several of their different Arab nation neighbors there, which in one way is uniting them with Israel against Iran. But I have never had a great, I don't have a lot of belief in what they say and what they do. They would put on a good face towards Israel as long as Israel's willing to fight against their enemy. But as soon as their enemy is vanquished, they soon turn right back onto Israel. So just keep that in mind. Israel does have a program right now coming up, should be active within the next year, that they will be using lasers to knock out any incoming missiles. You may want to pray for this as well, as this protects the peace in Israel. But we know that the true peace only comes through our Father and our Mashiach. And with that, I'm done with my prayer request, and I'm ready to start the study here today. Now, I gave this study 2 or 3 years ago at the Feast of Tabernacles, because some people failed to understand one of the principles that you, Jackson, had brought up several times in the past, and that is the second tithe. I was very blessed when I came into the Worldwide Church of GOD to have learned about the tithe. I understood the first tithe. I didn't know anything about the second, third, or fourth. And don't let that scare you, because I will explain this in more detail. But when I first came in and understood about the tithing, I did not understand at that time of the second tithe. So the first Feast of Tabernacles I went to, I was married at that time. We were newly married. We went to the Feast of Tabernacles in Wisconsin Dells, which is a good 160 miles from here at least. And that's if you fly cross country. Anyhow, we got there on $120. We spent the whole 8 days in the Wisconsin Dells and never lacked for a thing, because our brothers and sisters who had been taught about the second tithe understood how to use that second tithe. And that's one of the things I want to bring out in this study. So we're first introduced to the tithing in the scriptures in the account of Abraham, when he fought against the kings and brought back the loot that had been stolen from Sodom and Gomorrah. And when he came back, he was approached by Melchizedek, as the English renders him. And he was blessed by Melchizedek. And as we read in Leviticus 27:30, it says, "And all the tithe of the land, the seed of the land, or of the fruit of the tree belongs to Yahuwah. It is set apart to Yahuwah." This is where we become first familiar that even though he gives to us, he expects us to give back to him out of respect of his authority. Where the first concept of tithe comes from, we are not really sure. As I said, the first reading that we have of it in the scriptures is in Genesis 14:20. And we know that in the garden, Adam was created in perfection. As being perfect in all his ways prior to their fall, I am sure that they understood the need to give back to Yah to show appreciation for all that he gave to them. And I often wonder if Yah had not participated in the meals with them and had an intimate relationship with them that, you know, we could only long for and hope for in the future. But the principle of tithing, as I say, we do not know its first use, but we do know that Abraham gave back to Melchizedek, and that in the Torah we see many references to the tithing. Also, going back to Leviticus 27, we read in 31 through 33, "If a man indeed redeems any of his tithe, he adds one-fifth to it, and the entire tithe of the herd and of the flock, all that passes under the rod, the tenth one is set apart to Yahuwah. He does not inquire whether it is good or it is spoiled, nor does he exchange it. And if he exchanges it at all, then both it and the one exchanged for it are set apart. It is not redeemed." So Yah takes a very serious look at this tithe, and that if we are, and I'm not sure how this would work. I look for the day when our Mashiach explains some of these things to us. Apparently the Levite had something to do with establishing a value of an animal that was used as tithe. I don't think that would apply so much to what we read in verse 30 of the seed or the fruit. But we do know that the tithe was something that Abba Yah commanded us to give. So the first thing that we need to realize is in the ancient world, it was all based on an agricultural society. Almost everyone derived their living through agriculture, raising and selling, whether it be the fruit of the land or the animals of their flocks and herds. And this gives rise to the fact that you will see many pagan religions requiring that their people give so much to them. I've heard that there are some that even require a 30% of the gross. So anyhow, all of this needs to be understood through those verses in Leviticus 27, verses 30 through 33. We now turn to Numbers in 18, verse 21 and 24, where we see that the tithe was to go to the Levites for their service. And we note here, only the Levitical priesthood was to receive this tithe. Now, this is important, and don't anyone jump the gun on me here, because I will explain something further along. But in Numbers 18, 21, we see, and it says, And see, I have given the children of Levi all the tithes in Israel as an inheritance, in return for the service which they are serving. And also in verse 24, but the tithe of the children of Israel, which they present as a contribution to Yahuwah, I have given to the Levites as an inheritance. Now, of course, we do not have the Levitical priesthood with us today. There are those in Israel right now who claim to be Levites. Whether that's been proven or not, I have no idea. I don't know if they actually can prove an inheritance of that sort. But they are claiming that they alone should be receiving the tithe. But if you will read through some of these scriptures, and I'm going to get to another one shortly, where it says that these are contribution. And this is a very important term, because when we understand what the contribution is, we better understand how we should use this first tithe that we're to take out of our earnings. Far too many preachers, pastors, and priests have browbeat their congregations into believing that they must give them or their church their tithes. But this is not so. As I said, only the Levitical priesthood was designated as recipients. That being said, it's also important for us to understand that there is more than one tithe which the people were to set aside. Before we go into that, we'll look at the tithe of the tithe, which was commanded. And this is the second tithe that's commanded in the scriptures. And this we find in Numbers 18, 24 through 32, which we've already read. And so in there, we glean several important facts. First, we see in several places that it is stated only for the Levites. Also, in verse 26, in verse 26 here, we also read, speak to the Levites and say to them, when you take from the children of Israel the tithe which I have given you from them as your inheritance, then you shall present a contribution of it to Yahuwah, a tenth of the tithe. So we see that now the Levites themselves are commanded to give a tithe. This is the second tithe mentioned now. And as I said, this is only for the Levites. This is not something that we as a people need to be concerned over at this present time. Verse 28 tells us that this tithe of the Levites' tithe is to be brought to Aaron, the high priest. And in verse 29, we see that this tithe was to be the best of that which was brought by the common people to the Levitical priest. And we will also note that it is considered a free will offering. Now, this is where I say our tithe to the Levitical priesthood can come under a contribution known as a free will offering. In the past, I have had people offer me their tithes, and I tell them I cannot accept it because I am not a Levite. If they will give it as a free will offering, a contribution, then I can accept it. But as long as it is termed a tithe, it's not for me to accept. It is for the Levite alone. It was to be given freely and not in a grudging way. One last thing that we will notice before moving on is that the remaining 90% of the tithe of the tithe could be eaten any place by anyone in the priest's household. So it didn't matter if they were unclean at that time or not. After the first tithe, or after the tithe of the tithe had been taken out, anybody in the priest household can eat, and I think this is including the servants, could partake of the tithe that had been given. This covers the first tithe and the tithe of the tithe, which was explicitly for the Levitical priesthood. We will now take a look at two other tithes, which was to come from the children of Israel. As we have seen, the tithe was commanded to be brought to the Levite. But now, in Deuteronomy 14, 20 through, 22 through 26, we read, "You shall tithe without fail all the yield of your grain that the field brings forth year by year. And you shall eat before Yahweh your Elohim in the place where he chooses to make his name dwell, the tithe of your grain and your new wine and your oil and of the firstlings of your herds and of your sheep, so that you will learn to fear Yahweh your Elohim always. But when the way is too long for you so that you are not able to bring the tithe, or when the place where Yahweh your Elohim chooses to put his name is too far from you, when Yahweh your Elohim is blessing you, then you shall give it into silver and shall take the silver in your hand and go to the place which Yahweh your Elohim chooses. And you shall use the silver for whatever your heart desires, for cattle or sheep, for wine or strong drink, for whatever your being desires. And you shall eat there before Yahweh your Elohim and shall rejoice, you and your household." So we see now that here's a tithe that does not go to the Levites. It's given to us and for us to use when we go up to the three regalim, the three high days that are commanded. And this is Yah's way of providing for his people, especially those who do not live in the direct vicinity of Jerusalem, where the temple was. This gave the people who lived farther away the ability to make it to the feast and to provide a Sukkot, a place to keep their feast, as well as providing for the food and drink that they would need throughout that time. And as I said, this is part of the three high days that we are commanded. And if we go into Leviticus 23, which I will not do here, but I'm sure we're all familiar with the feasts that are outlined there. So, and we see that there are three certain ones that are commanded that when we go up to them, we are not to come empty-handed. We are to be bringing that second tithe so that we can provide for ourselves during those feasts. And I'm just going to read Deuteronomy 16:16 quick. It says, "Three times a year shall all your males appear before Yahweh your Elohim in the place that he shall choose, at Hag Matzah, at Shavuot, and at Hag Sukkot. And they shall not appear before Yahweh empty-handed." And we also notice in 14 that we are to rejoice with your son, your daughter, your male servant, your female servant, and the Levite, as well as the stranger in your gates, along with the fatherless and the widow. So we need to break down what we've just read and see if we can reach a logical conclusion to all this. First, there are three times a year that all of our males were to come before Yahuwah to celebrate three special feasts. They are not to come second, they are not to come empty-handed. Third, if not for all three of the feasts, at least at Sukkot, they were to bring their family. We read that in Deuteronomy 14, in 23, it says, "We are to eat in the place that he shall choose, the tithe of your increase." Number 5, 14:24, If it is too far for you to take it, take all of it, all of the above, it is to be changed into cash or silver and to be bestowed on whatever your being desires. And six is, we see this in 16:14. We are to share that tithe with those who are less blessed. We've already seen that the first tithe was to be given to the Levite. So that the tithe we see in Deuteronomy 14 is a third tithe now, in the addition to the first tithe to be given to the Levite and the tithe of the tithe, which the Levite was to give to Yahweh. So before we move on to the last and fourth tithe, it may help to look at this second tithe in its practical terms. Because we live in a less agricultural society, we use social condition, or we will use social conditions to find that we find today. We will also use a modest income of $40,000 a year after expenditures. One tithe of $40,000 would equal $4,000. And this is only for explanationary purposes. The first tithe, now a free will offering, one tithe of the $40,000 is $4,000. The second tithe, and we're not, actually this is the third tithe because we're not counting the tithe of the Levites. We're not affected by that. So the second tithe that we are accountable for is to be used at the feast. And it's my personal belief that this tithe can be used at all of the three commanded high days, the unleavened bread, Shavuot, and Sukkot. If we go to the Sukkot with that $4,000 now, that's tithe that we have, that's a lot of money for us to spend in that 8-day period, an awful lot of money. Personally, I've been to the feast in years when I've had a considerable amount of money like this. And those years at the feast were probably the greatest blessings to me. And the reason for that is because understanding how the second tithe was supposed to be used and seeing the example that was given to me, the very first Feast of Tabernacles that I had attended, I was able to see how this second tithe could be a blessing to other people. And when you bless somebody, you're going to be blessed even greater in return. This is one of Yah's, I don't know how it works. It's one of his established ways that no matter how much you bless somebody, he's always going to bless you more. And so when you take this $4,000 to the feast, now you have money that you can take other people out to dinner. You can find a widow. You can find somebody who is so elderly that they're not able to afford the feast. You can provide for their feast funds. It's just a wonderful thing. And another thing that became a habit, a common thing with me, was every time I went to the feast, I would buy presents for my family back home, because we did not keep the pagan days, especially around the December 25th time. I always made it a point to give them gifts as soon as I came back from Sukkot. And it usually had something, some relationship to that particular area where I went to Sukkot. And in this, I've been blessed greatly because having kept Sukkot since 1972, I've been to a lot of places. Never been out of the country for Sukkot. Actually, never really desired to outside of Israel. But it's just a great blessing to be able to go to those places. And then when you come back, and another thing, when I had the ability to, we even bought presents for my children's teachers that would have a relationship to that, so that this would give our children the chance to get up, give the teacher this, and explain where they had been and what we had done. So we're now ready to look at the third tithe. Those who had never heard, well, actually this is the third tithe for us, the fourth tithe in reality. Those who have never heard of or studied this tithing issue are often critical of it. And I can understand why. When you start talking about taking 30% of someone's income, especially if they're not on a upper end of the middle class or upper class, you are talking about an awful lot of money. So you start talking about 30% of your income and people are saying, well, I'm taxed enough. How can I afford this? Well, the thing of it is, if we read in Deuteronomy 14 and 28 through 29, and I think I have that right here. Okay, and 28. At the end of every third year, and that's important, the third year, you bring out all the tithe of your increase of that year, not every year, that year, and you store it up within your gates. And the Levite, because he has no inheritance or portion with you, and the stranger and the fatherless and the widow who are within your gates shall come and eat and be satisfied. So we see here that this last third tithe was a sort of like a social security program, a social program rather. It was a program where you provided, every third year you provided for someone's need. And if you look at this from a perspective of a large group, you would have people giving every year into a third tithe and giving back to the Levites to provide for the poor among them. So this is something, it's a concept that, like I say, people have a hard time relating to today because we are taxed so much as it is. But here is one of the things that I think. There's two thoughts on this concerning the understanding of this tithe. One is that the tithe is figured off of the $32,000 that is left after we take our first tithe. And I'm just using a relative number here for convenience. So after you've taken that $40,000 income, you've taken your first tithe out of it, you've already taken out $4,000. You've taken your second tithe out, now you're down to $32,000. So, like I say, one way of looking at this is that you take a tithe off of that $32,000 once every 3 years. There's another way that it is done, and this is the one that I do, and it's much like the tithe of the tithes. It's found in Numbers 18:26. And in this case, that amount would be $400. So you have that particular year, that third year, you have a $4,000 tithe to spend at the feast, second tithe to spend at the feast. You take a tithe off of that, that's $400. And this is only done every third year. And now another aspect of this is something that a brother brought up to me years ago. We live in a nation that already taxes us year by year for a program to help others. And so he looked at it in that perspective and used it as that is the way that he paid his third tithe, the third tithe that we have as common people. He paid that third tithe off of whatever the sum was at the end of that third year. So a final thought in all this is that Yahweh has blessed us in many rich ways, especially in this Western world. And as we no longer live under the Levitical priesthood, we've come far from a full and true understanding of the Torah, of all of these Torah principles. Even the way we keep Yahweh's feast vary from one assembly to the next. we must practice, and this is the key word, practice keeping of Torah as the Ruach HaKodesh leads us. And we are commanded to try the spirits, whether they be from Elohim or not. If they live up to the Torah standards as best as we're given the discernment, that is the best we can hope to do. But we should always be studying his word and asking for his Ruach to guide us and direct us in this into a further and deeper understanding. Through the Ruach, we are given an understanding which can be confirmed via scriptures. We must follow through with that understanding, or else we can grieve the Spirit and the Spirit will leave us. So I'm hoping that this helps people understand how important the tithing system was, how wonderful our Almighty had things already worked out when he gave these to Moses, and how if we will obey these things today, we would not have the problems that we see as far as poverty, people being displaced because they can't afford their homes. There's a much better way of doing things, and Yah has shown them to us through his Torah. With that, I turn the meeting back over to Brother Jackson, and I bless you all.
That was an excellent message, and it was authentic as well, and it was true. The way I think of it is the first tithe goes to your ministers. The second tithe goes to yourself. It's a vacation fund. And so you'll have the money to go to the feasts. Then the third tithe is whatever is left of that second tithe that you didn't spend that you can use for yourself, or you can use it for the welfare of others, anything you want. Then there is the offering. The offering is for particular causes in the assembly, like our mission program. Yes. That's an offering. And then there's alms that go to the poor, and that's whatever you want, if you want. So it really, you know, the churches have messed up people's understanding of this to the point where, you know, I've got to give my 10% so we can build a new steeple on the church. That kind of thing. And it's just completely wrong. But this is the right way to go. And it works. It works. Whether you have a lot of money or a little money, you can still afford this. And it's Torah. Well, that's my take on it. James, you have anything else to say on that?
I had to unmute myself. I didn't want to, in case my dogs start barking or something.
Oh, okay.
But, no, I can't really add more to it. But like I say, that first tithe, when people try to offer that to me, I do tell them I cannot accept it because I'm not a Levite, but I can accept a free will offering. This is what the scriptures tell us.
The way I figure it is, the only Levites Yahweh has today are not blood Levites because they do not serve Yahweh through Yahshua. And they don't even serve Yahweh at all because they can't even mention the name.
Exactly.
When the scripture tells us that the name is to be used in common conversation. So who is? Don't tell me that Yahweh doesn't have Levites on earth, or that the Levites are just unknown people living in Israel or India or some place. No, there's somebody here today, and that is those that offer you your spiritual sustenance in the name of Yahshua to Yahweh.
Well, it could be too, because I do not consider myself as a teacher. I consider myself more as a mediator of Torah to help people better understand Torah. This has been my study since I first came into the knowledge.
I have a good idea that maybe Yahweh considers you a Levite. I know that it might seem big-headedness, but it's just a fact. You are. So if you don't feel worthy of that, think of the Levites that are going around today, the blood Levites. They're not worthy of anything. They deny the master. And think, well, who is going to go for me?
Well, we are called to be kings and priests.
Amen. All right. I'll be a king and you can be a priest. How would that
be? I'd rather the other way around, but however.
All right. You're a very humble fellow, and I thank you for that message, and we all do. You know, it's very good to know that you're going to be on here like first Shabbat of each month. That is, that's very good for me to know. Thank you.
Well, I thank you for the opportunity. And again, God bless you all.
Okay. Hyacin. The Shema.
Shema, Yisrael, Yahweh Eloheinu is one, Yahweh.
We will love Yahweh, our Elohim, with all our hearts and with all our souls and with all our strengths. And these words that Yahweh commands us will be in our hearts, and we will teach them diligently to our children, and we'll talk of them when we sit in our houses, and when we walk down the road, and when we recline, and when we arise. And we'll bind them for a sign upon our hands, and they will be adornments between our eyes. And we will write them on the supports of our houses, and even on our gates.
Zakar, remember. When you became the Yahad of Israel, you vowed to separate yourselves from the sessions of the deceitful in order to depart into the wilderness to prepare the way of Yahweh. As it is written, in the wilderness, prepare the way of Yahweh, make level in the desert a highway for our Elohim. This alludes to the study of the Torah and Kadosh writings that Yahweh Elohim commanded through Moshe, according to everything that has been revealed from time to time, and according to what has been revealed to the prophets by his Kadosh Ruach.
And all this we will gladly remember and gladly do.
And so we, creatures of clay kneaded with water, a heap of dust, and a heart of stone, for what virtue are we reckoned to be worthy of this? For into an ear of dust you have put a new word and have engraved everlasting things on hearts of stone. You have caused strained spirits to return that they may enter into covenant with you and stand before you forever, even in the everlasting abode, illuminated with perfect light forever, with no more darkness, for unending moeds of joy and unnumbered ages of peace. Shalom, shalom.
Shalom, shalom. And the service is finito. Thank you for attending. This is a good service. I enjoyed it very much, but especially the wonderful company that we get to keep between you and I and between the Father, our Creator. And I believe our master is anywhere where two or three are gathered. Let's see what's going on this week. Do you have anything, Greg? Is Hebrew Games still going on?
No, that completed last Yom Rishon. So we had a few people that came in. But I think what I'm doing, what I think about doing now is, for those who have some advanced knowledge, I've got the, set, I've got a new book with program with audio and everything for a conversational for people who have the alphabet memorized and the vowel sounds memorized at minimum, and maybe know some basic vocabulary at minimum. So that's my next project. I already got the books purchased. They'll be available for viewing in the Zoom room, just like the first class I did.
Excellent. I think that's just what we need too, especially with that first Hebrew class. I think that you can find people there would like to go on. And Tuesday night, we're going to get together and talk. What was that, Sean? We decided to talk about Paul. Anybody that wants to come, it feels like talking, wants to hash things out. We're going to do that on Tuesday night, 10 o'clock p.m. It might be too late for you, but we want to try to get some people on the West Coast. Haven't been too successful at that. However, we'd love to see you come, talk, or listen. We had one last Tuesday night, and it was fantastic. So if you can, go out there to youtubeone.org and listen to that discussion. You'll get an idea what it's all about. We hope to do something like the controversial topics forum that we had a couple of years ago, eventually. And so in the meantime, we're just going to talk really about anything you want to talk about. So we'll see you there Tuesday evening. Also, yes, we are going to do Tabernacles this year. And it's in a place called Mouth of Wilson, Virginia, right on the North Carolina border, about 3 hours to the east of Knoxville. So start accumulating on that second tithe. This is how you can go. There's no reason to think you don't have money. And when you don't go, you're missing a huge blessing that you're going to remember all the time. And you are, and I'm afraid to say this, but you are not living a Torah life unless you find a way to do this ingathering. And it's about ingathering. You come together with the people that you're like-minded with, and you spend a week in worship and fun. And fun. Remember that what James said today about strong drink? Did you ever know you could take a second tithe and it says buy all the strong drink you want? If that's what you want to do, that's fine. But we have good, wholesome fun there, and we're doing it out in a rather primitive fashion. There are motel rooms around there too. You don't have to stay the whole time, but remember the big days are the first day, that'd be October 5th. That's a big worship day. And the next week on the Wednesday, that is the last great day. Will there be internet there? No, we don't know right now. But what we are going to do, if there isn't, is we're going to use hotspots. Hotspots. Yeah, well, that's all right. We can have.
Yeah, do you know what the carrier is there, Jack?
No, I don't know. We'll find that out. We're just in the starting to work on this. Perhaps you could help us with that. We might have some hard cider. How would that be? Okay, anything else?
Jackson, I made a mistake, but I'm trying to type in on chat a contact email for anyone who would like to help plan or, now I've lost my chat. Okay, here we go.
We need some help on this, just to plan, whether you're planning to go or not. We need minds that are good at planning activities, meals, classes. And I'm starting now to look for keynote speakers as well.
And also practical things like how to build a tent, how to set up a tent.
Yeah.
We have lots of tents here that we can share. And we have cots and camping equipment. But we need somebody who can be over the fire, the campfires, over the setting up the tents, over helping people with the I'm not a camper, so I need help.
You need, well, I tell you, I
need help.
I'm so decrepit, I can't even set up a tent. Ask Kenneth. He sets mine up for me. Or you don't have to do a tent. We have some rooms there that may be available. Also, if you got a recreational vehicle, there are certainly places nearby there. So again, thank you. You're not a hardy soul, no, but you can have help. You can have help. You don't have to admit anything. We already know that. You are the deaf Torah singer. You can do anything. Okay, y'all. Love you. Enjoy your week.